Thank you everyone for joining us for the Women's Oncology 2021 webinar. Without wasting any time, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our first speaker for the evening. Our first speaker is Dr. Jovita Martin Daniel, who is the Associate Professor and Consultant Medical Oncologist at RCMC Hospital, Chennai. Over to you, ma'am.
Can I start?
Yes, ma'am. Please go ahead, ma'am.
And is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am. Your screen is visible as well.
Good evening, one and all. I thank Isai for this wonderful opportunity. And over and above everything, I think being a part of the Women's Oncology Meet is really, really important because some of my very good mentors and trainers were women. I cannot but say that Dr. Kalachilri and Dr. Anita Ramesh have been my very good teachers and they've been a wonderful example. And amidst so many of my juniors, colleagues, who are all ladies, I mean, we are oncology warriors, I would say. And I think it's, I take immense pleasure in being a part of this meeting. Going on to the meeting for today, I'm an advocate of Eribulin. This evening. So I'm going to discuss about seven studies and that will be the overview of today's talk. Background is that Eribulin has been the only single agent to improve the overall survival in two indications, metastatic breast cancer and soft tissue sarcoma, that is liposarcoma type. Now, if you would see this slide, in the last 35 years, we've had around hundreds of studies that are there, but amongst that, only 19 studies have really shown some overall survival benefit in metastatic breast cancer. And amongst them would be some of these that I'm quoting today. And twice proven, Halavin, this particular drug has proven itself in its efficacy in metastatic breast cancer as well as advanced liposarcoma. If you would see the slide, you would definitely appreciate the fact that, 13.2% 2 months with metastatic breast cancer versus 10.6 months in control arm, and in liposarcoma, 15.6 months versus 8.4 months. And there are four main trials which have quoted its efficiency. The quote is the Halavin study, the Maki et al. Study and the Chawla et al. Study. And in place of Eribulin, it has been effective both in HER2 negative and triple negative breast cancer. And it's been incorporated in the NCCN as well. If you would see here with the orange box as a preferred regimen and as a single agent in recurrent and unresectable stage 4 disease. Now let's briefly talk about the review of two phase 3 clinical trials of Eribulin. The first one being the EMBRACE, and we all have heard about the study. It's a phase 3 open label randomized study, 305 is its name. It's a global open label randomized phase 3 study where locally advanced, locally recurrent metastatic breast cancer who have had two to five prior chemotherapy regimens, either exposed to anthracycline or taxanes, and progression should have been at least more than 6 months from the last chemotherapy with a lesser grade of neurotherapy and better performance of 0 or 1. The two arms were either Eribulin at the rate of 1.4 milligram per meter squared over 2 to 5 minutes on days 1 and 8 of every 3 week. The treatment of physician's choice, which could be either any biological agent or hormonal agent or cytotoxic chemotherapy or palliative treatment or radiotherapy. Now, randomization was 2:1, and the primary endpoint was overall survival. The secondary endpoint was progression-free survival or overall response rate or safety. Now, look at this slide. It's so evident that at 1 year, Eribulin has given an overall median survival of 53.9%, whereas the treatment for physician's choice was only 43.7 months. And the median overall survival was 13.1 month versus 10.6, which means that there is basically a 2.5 months longer period of survival with eribulin. And this was basically analyzed at 442 events. That is, amongst the total population, intent to treat population, when about 422 deaths occurred, that is 55% of the intent to treat population were dead. And that was the time that they evaluated this particular Kaplan-Meier curve. And but you would see at 18 months, that is at 1.5 years, there is a kind of crossover. Now, this is a kind of delusional picture. This is because of the fact that there is an immaturity of the data resulting because of the censoring of patients who were actually still alive at the time of analysis. They were not taken into account. So that is the reason why this crossover happened. And then we have the updated overall survival analysis. This was done when 77% of the intent to treat population were dead, which means that there was 589 events. And at this time, again, the median survival was better with eribulin, with advantage of 2.7 months longer. You would see at 1 year, at 54.5% versus 42.8%, and at 2 years, 21.9 versus 19.2%. And overall, there is a paralleling of the curve in favor of eribulin. Now, US FDA review of the EMBRACE clinical trial takeaways are that it is a very properly designed but consistent data results across the subgroups. And the updated survival analysis, the primary analysis also had a p-value of 0.0141. The updated analysis had a better p-value of 0.014. So basically the result was consistent and overall survival most likely to be true as a treatment effect. And safety profile also was manageable. And conclusion here is that it's a very significant improvement in overall survival in with patients who have had heavily pretreated metastatic breast cancer. And there has been a prolongation of overall survival, and it's been realistic and achievable when evaluating the new therapies that we have had in women with heavily pretreated metastatic breast cancer, like we have the immunotherapy and IO combinations and so on. This being a very simple chemotherapeutic agent is able to produce a good result. And it also had manageable toxicity. Now we come to the second trial, which is the 301 phase 3 open label randomized multicenter trial, where they compared eribulin versus capecitabine. Now this again was in locally advanced or metastatic breast cancer, and about less than 3 lines of chemotherapies were given. And more so, it was more of a taxane exposed or an anthracycline exposed. And we would compare eribulin as the first arm, and the number was 554 patients, with capecitabine at the rate of 1,250 milligram per meter squared BD orally, day 1 to day 14 of every 3-weekly cycle. Now the primary endpoints were overall survival, and the secondary endpoints were the quality of life, overall response rate, duration of response, and the safety. The patients were stratified according to the geographical region and the HER2 status. Now, according to the statistical considerations for the primary endpoints, the predefined analysis was done based on a two-sided log rank test and stratified for the HER2 as well as the geographical region, and the overall survival determination was at 905 events. Now, the pre-specified subgroup analysis, if we would see here, when the HER2 was positive, the result was in favor of capecitabine. When it was negative, it was in favor of eribulin. But in ERPR status, ER status, and the positive or negative, irrespective of its status, it was in favor of eribulin compared to capecitabine. In triple negative also, triple negative, when it was positive, definitely the it was favoring eribulin. Overall, if you would see, there seemed not much of a difference in terms of the months. And selective adverse events, we would see, it was more for neutropenia and alopecia, and also peripheral sensory neuropathy. The author's conclusion here was that actually the trial didn't really demonstrate a statistically significant superiority with eribulin compared to capecitabine because it was just a meager number of months survival in excess. But the pre-specified exploratory analysis suggested that there was favor of eribulin in cases of triple negative breast cancer, ER negative and HER2 negative. Now let's look at this pre-specified subgroup analysis of this particular data, 301. Here, if you would see, the overall survival for triple negative breast cancer at 124 events, that is, out of the 150 patients, 124 patients were no more. At that particular point, when they analyzed, they found that there was an overall benefit of OS 5 months. So 15.4 months versus 9.4 months in the overall survival between halavan and capecitabine. And the hazard ratio was significant. Now let's look at HER2 negative. Here also, when at the total number of patients were 375, but when 296 patients were lost, at this time when the evaluation was done, the overall survival benefit with eribulin was 2.4 months in comparison to capecitabine. Now, conclusion here is that in advanced and metastatic breast cancer with HER2 negative and estrogen receptor negative or triple negative breast cancers, particularly there was a benefit with eribulin as second line or third line chemotherapies. Now, the efficacy of eribulin in women with metastatic breast cancer, this is a pooled analysis of the two phase 3 trials that we have seen till now. If we would see the slide, here we see that 301 had a 1:1 randomization, 305 EMBRACE trial had a 2:1 randomization. And here 301, only 1 to 3 lines of chemotherapy patients were recruited here. 3 to 6 lines of chemotherapy patients were recruited. Overall, eribulin was 1,062 patients. And capecitabine with the treatment of choice, physician's choice was 802 patients. So what happened is that the European Regulatory Authority requested the pooled analysis of study 305 and 301, and they found that the information on the efficacy got revealed. And they really clearly could pinpoint and say that 2.4 months advantage in the improved overall survival of eribulin in comparison to control, whatever be the control that they used. Now, the hazard ratio for the overall survival of all the population and the subgroups, if we would see, shows a very significant difference in the median overall survival in favor of eribulin. And this forest plot clearly shows all the dots are on the left of the median line. And there is a specific better result with HER2 negative, triple negative, and visceral metastasis also. Now, conclusion here again is that the patients with HER2 negative disease represent about 85% of the women with metastatic breast cancer, and pooled analysis confirms that these women benefit significantly with eribulin and of particularly a clinical relevance. And women with triple negative breast cancer may derive a particularly strong benefit from eribulin. Let's look at the real world evidence of triple negative breast cancer. And this is a new study which confirms the robust efficacy of eribulin. This is a clinical benefit study that was done in a US community oncology setting. Now we all know that triple negative breast cancer is around 15 to 20% of all breast cancers. And when we compare the hormone receptor positive and the HER2 positive tumors, which averages a survival of around 50 months, the triple negative breast cancer gives us a meager of 11 to 17.8 months only. So now sequential therapy remains the mainstay of treatment for patients with triple negative breast cancer. Now the method that they used in this particular study is that it was a large retrospective community-based study of eribulin in triple negative breast cancer US. And the ones who have already participated in the clinical trials did not participate here. That was an exclusion criteria. And second primary malignancies and people not responding, they were also under care of some other physician, they were removed from the study. Now, the electronic case report form reviewed by the Cardinal Health Clinical Research They stratified accordance to the ECOG performance data, the drug regimens that was received up to initiation, the eribulin by line of treatment, whichever line it was, disease response, adverse events, and the date of death or last follow-up. This was the study design, where 252 electronic clinical record form was filled, completed for the triple negative breast cancer who were treated with eribulin. Now, the stratification was based upon whether they used it earlier on or later on. So earlier on means when the first or the second line eribulin was used, and later used was after third line or after. So this study was between January 2011 to January 2014. They evaluated the response rate and overall survival. And if you would see here in this particular, tabular column, the early response, early users, that is in the first line or second line of the usage of eribulin, the response rate was 69.9%, that is 23 months of survival. The later usage, third line and further, it was only 48.8%, 14.7 months survival. Now, the median survival definitely in all patients was 17.6 months, and the side effects were manageable. So basically, this helps us understand that it's going to be useful whether it is early user or late user. Why eribulin works so well in triple negative converting aggressive mesenchymal phenotype to epithelial phenotype, and also attenuating the immunomodulatory mechanism of action. Now, this is a very interesting point that I have also learned as I was going through the slide set. The comparative analysis of the molecular subclassification system, if you could see, there are three subclassification systems. PAM50, where there are five different types of the triple negative categorization. Lehman et al. Talks about seven different types of categorization, and Burstein et al. Had four categorizations. But overall, the significant proportion of the triple negative breast cancer patient had mesenchymal and immunomodulatory phenotypes. Now, eribulin actually has an additional mechanism of converting the aggressive mesenchymal phenotype to epithelial phenotype, and also does some kind of changes in the immunomodulatory response. Now, let's see how this goes. When we say epithelial membrane transition, this is the key metastasis promoting step in almost all cancers. Now, what is the epithelial type? Epithelial type is when the cell's integrity is preserved, the cellular polarity is present, the cell adhesion is present, then the cells are stationary, they are not mobile, they don't move, they don't slip out of the mainstream. There is very high level of E-cadherin and low level of N-cadherin. So this is the normal and the right way to present. Now, when there is an epithelial mesenchymal transition, what happens here is, in mesenchymal type, this is the bad type. This is what we do not want to have. Here, there'll be no cellular polarity. There'll be loss of cell adhesion, the ability to migrate and invade. There'll be low level of E-cadherin and high level of N-cadherin. So this is what is going to be a mischievous variety for us to deal with. Now, this is called as a cadherin switching, and is a hallmark of epithelial membrane transition. What does this mean? When the normal epithelial type transfers or transitions into the mesenchymal bad type, what happens is there'll be downregulation of E-cadherin and upregulation of N-cadherin. So when that cadherin switching happens, it causes dissemination of cancer cells into other distant tissues. There'll be dislocation, migration, invasion, extravasation, intravasation, and there'll also be macrometastasis formation. And there'll be cell dormancy. It'll try to go helter-skelter, and it'll try to find its niche in different organs. Now, if you would like to find out in an immunohistochemistry point of view, whether we're really dealing with epithelial phenotype or mesenchymal phenotype, here are the markers. In epithelial type, we have expression of cytokeratins 18 and 19, whereas in mesenchymal type, the bad variety, we have the snail slug, twist, fibronectin, and vimentin being expressed. Now, what is a consequence of epithelial mesenchymal transition in breast cancer? Let's look at this. When we use the word anoikis, it's a Greek word which says homelessness, which means when the cells are, you know, dismantled, it moves away from the epithelial cell variety and loses its polarity. What normally happens is that those cells will be induced into apoptosis and will be destroyed. But in a case where the epithelial to mesenchymal transition takes place, this anoikis resistance will happen. That means there will not be apoptosis of the strayed cells. The strayed cells will start invading, migrating. It'll start evading the immune system and causing resistance to chemotherapy and radiotherapy. Now, this oncogenic epithelial membrane transition in breast cancer can lead to the acquisition of pro-metastatic features as well. Now, this is a paper which has a scientific proof of a prognostic value of the EMT-inducing transcription factors in metastatic breast cancer. There is a correlation between, excuse me, between the expression of EMT transcription factors and the prognostic value of MBC patients. Here they found that 3,218 metastatic breast cancer patients from 14 eligible studies were evaluated, and they found that the higher the EMT transcription factors expression, the poorer will be the metastatic breast cancer patients' results. And this is often seen with the Asian patients as well. Now look at this trimodal molecular mechanism of eribulin in metastatic breast cancer. What really happens when eribulin acts on these cells? Normally there's a lot of hypoxic cells. Now eribulin causes the vascular remodeling with increase in the tumor microvascular density, and the hypoxic cells decrease, and the CA9, the marker decreases. This is first part. Hypoxia-inducible factor decreases. There'll be a regulation and improvement of microenvironment. So what happens when this hypoxia decreases? Clinical implication is that there'll be an increased subsequently delivered drug delivery, and decrease in hypoxia induces better consequences. Now, the next is that there'll be a mesenchymal to epithelial phenotype switch. Instead of epithelial to mesenchymal switch, there is a reverse from the mesenchymal to epithelial switch. So this is done by increasing the E-cadherin, decreasing the N-cadherin and vimentin. And also there is immune evasion. Okay, so basically by making this happen, the tumor becomes less aggressive. By having the immune evasion, there'll be less expression of PD-L1, CD8, FOXP3, and thereby local infiltration of T-cells will be better. Now, this is the tabular column which shows us the clinical significance of epithelial to mesenchymal transition and the different markers that we have. And I guess eventually this will all come into the real world, you know, usage. Evolution of heterogeneity over time. Now, there are two models in this. One is a clonal evolution. Here, a single mutated cell acquires additional varied mutation. The different colors show different mutations, and they progress. When they progress, they take two parts. One part is linear evolution over time. The next is branched evolution over time. Then we have the cancer stem cells. Over time, what happens here is that the clonogenic multipotent cancer stem cells have the potential to form new cancer cells, and it is a variety within the cells which gives rise to heterogeneity observed within the tumors, and therefore the clinical manifestations. Now we come to the fifth trial here. The effect to anti-tumor autoimmune response of eribulin is illustrated by the Osaka City University conducted with a clinical investigation on 52 patients with locally advanced and metastatic breast cancer who've been treated with eribulin. What they did is they actually did a biopsy before treatment and after treatment for 10 patients. And they correlated the response rate with immunohistochemistry to check for the TILs. And they checked the PD-1 on the TILs, CD8 and FOXP3 on the TILs. On the cancer cells, they checked the PD-L1 and PD-L2 and the epithelial membrane transition markers like the E-cadherin, N-cadherin, vimentin and CA9. Let's see what happened in the comparison of EMT and hypoxic markers of expression before and after the treatment. We see here the increase of expression of epithelial markers, E-cadherin, after eribulin treatment. Clearly, the line goes up in the line diagram. And also N-cadherin, there is a slope down, which means there is a decrease in the mesenchymal marker of N-cadherin after the eribulin treatment. Here, vimentin, there's a decreased expression of mesenchymal marker vimentin after eribulin treatment. And CA9 also, there's a decreased expression of hypoxic marker CA9 after eribulin. Look at the immune environment marker expression after the treatment of eribulin. Here also we see that there is a decrease of PD-1, PD-L1 and PD-L2 expression after eribulin. Clearly there is a slope down. Here also there is a slope down except for one. An increase in the expression of PD-8 markers, which means that there is enhanced killer T cells and fewer regulatory T cells, which means the tumor, a reduced tumor in tolerance against the against tumors. Now, this is a very interesting slide. This particular three rows, let me explain this. So generally, when we have an untreated tumor, we have a little bit of hypoxic cells and a lot of oxic cells here. And basically, the development of resistance is energetically costly for this kind of a tumor when no treatment is given. And therefore, what happens is resistant cells, the hypoxic cells don't expand, but the oxic cell starts expanding. But in a case where we are trying to kill the tumor cells, like the kill strategy that we adopt through the chemotherapy, what happens here is that this is the tumor cells. Now, after the treatment, with the kind of chemotherapy and the dosing and the intensity that we are going to deploy, we are going to destroy all the tumor cells all around the resistant cells. And eventually, after the treatment, the resistance to clone starts increasing. Now we have come into a contingency containment strategy. What is that? This is cutting off the source, which means that instead of going in for the killing strategy, we have a slightly different containment strategy here. We are using adaptive therapy, which is designed to have treatment holidays, intermittent dosing, dose reductions, and other strategies by which we kill the hypoxic oxic cells, but we slowly actually deal with the resistant cells as well. So this is the philosophy with which eribulin works. The summary of the off-target effects will be is that eribulin acts on the vascular remodeling. It acts to transform the malignant phenotype to a better phenotype to deal with by abrogating the transforming growth factor beta and the SMAD pathway. And the third, it attenuates the immune system for a better modulating tumor phenotype. Now we all know that eribulin, the mechanism of action is, it is an anti-mitotic mechanism of action where there is a G2 M-phase cell cycle block and disruption of the mitotic spindles. And ultimately there'll be apoptotic death because of the mitotic blockage. But what happens here, as I said previously, it acts on microvessels, it attenuates the immune system, and it does change the epithelial, mesenchymal to epithelial form. Now let's look at the real world evidence of the HER2 negative metastatic breast cancer. We all know how important CDK4/6 inhibitors are at this point. Now this is the sixth study I will be talking about. It's an observational study of the clinical outcomes of eribulin on already treated CDK4/6 patients. The objective here was to find out the safety and the tolerability and the efficiency of eribulin in these kind of patients. And the response assessment was done through the RECIST criteria version 1.1. And the overall response rate, the diameters of all the lesions were measured up to 2 per metastatic site. Now this figure shows the cohort 1, use of Halloween after the CDK4/6 inhibitors in the second line, right after the CDK4/6 failure. In cohort 2, as a third line, after another treatment. In cohort 3, as a fourth line. And in cohort 4, after the fourth line, fifth line or sixth line, and so on. Now, in all the four cohorts, multiple sites of metastasis were seen: bone, brain, adrenal gland, distant lymph nodes, and so on, and also visceral mets. The ECOG performance status were not exactly 0-1. Even poor ECOG performance status patients were chosen. Now let's look at the results here. It's very interesting to note that this is expected in the second line, right out of the CDK4/6 and usage. The overall response rate was 42.2% and the clinical benefit was 58.7%. But we also see pretty much a kind of good response with third line and fourth line also, with a fairly good clinical benefit rate. And overall, we have observed that eribulin appeared to be well tolerated with very few treatment-related discontinuations observed in this study, and pretty much good clinical benefit also, which was not less than that observed in the pivotal trials, which we already discussed, when used at diverse points in the treatment pathway. Now, this is the last seventh study I'll be discussing. The effectiveness and safety of eribulin in Japanese patients with HER2-negative advanced breast cancer, a two-year post-marketing surveillance observation study in a real-world setting. In this study, if we would see, this was a large prospective observational study and the post-marketing observational study, which they enrolled the patient between September 2014 to February 2016 in Japan, followed up for 2 years. And they categorized eribulin use as first line, second line, third line, and later lines. They had recruited, registered around 651 patients, and 637 patients were included in the safety and effective analysis. Now, the baseline characteristics were based upon premenopausal or postmenopausal, whatever be the ECOG performance and hormone receptor status. And also the triple negative or HER2 negative, and his history of radiotherapy given, and multiple sites of metastasis. Let's look at the overall survival here. Here also we see in the first line, median survival in months, 22.8 months. At the first year, it was 71.6%. Second year, it was 48.3%. In second line also, there was a good survival in months, 16.3 months. At 1 year, it was 58.2%, and at 2 years, 37%. So there was a very robust efficacy with the second line HER2 negative MBC, which confirmed that this single agent is actually pretty active and it's efficacious. Of course, there were side effects like the neutropenia, peripheral neuropathy, and malaise, fatigue in first line, second line, as well as third line, but they were all manageable across the board in all baseline characteristics. Conclusion is that the effectiveness and the safety results of eribulin as a first and the second line treatment in a clinical setting were favorable and in line with the previously pre-approval clinical and post-marketing study results. So now there has been a very consistent and a convincing data in terms of the survival superiority and the recent large randomized controlled trial has elucidated it. And eribulin has been very effective in its rating in NCCN as well as very effective. So the approval indications as I advocate for eribulin this evening is for second line, subsequent lines of metastatic breast cancer and triple negative and ERBR positive post CDK4/6 inhibitor in HER2 negative, and also in the second line liposarcoma. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We'll now move on to the panel discussion. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our moderator. Our moderator is Dr. Anita Ramesh. She's the head of department, medical oncology at Savita Medical College and Hospital, and consultant medical oncologist at Kaveri Hospital. Her panelists are Dr. Jovita Martin Daniel from SRMC Hospital, Chennai, Dr. Anu Susan George, consultant medical oncologist from VPS Lakeshore, Kochi, Dr. Bindu SM, clinical oncologist from Trivandrum, Dr. Nitya Sridharan, a consultant medical oncologist, VS Hospitals, Chennai. Dr. Vidya Pari, a consultant medical oncologist, Universal Hospital, Salem. With that, I'll hand over the mic to Anita ma'am. Over to you, ma'am. Ma'am, I'm stopping your video. It seems that your network is a little low. Himanshi, can you confirm if you can hear, ma'am?
Unable to hear, ma'am.
Okay. It seems that we have a technical issue at ma'am's end. Till that time, would it be possible, if you have any questions for Jovita ma'am, we can address them. I think Anita ma'am is just logged in.
Yeah, I have again logged in.
Yes, ma'am.
You can have the slides.
Yeah. Sure, ma'am. Himanshi, can you share the slides, please? Ma'am, I hope the slides are visible on your screen.
Yeah, it's visible. Okay, can we proceed?
Yes, ma'am, please go.
So, it's for choosing chemotherapy. Yeah, for HER2 negative and triple negative breast cancer. Let's discuss as we move into the next slides.
Ma'am, can I request you to the ID where your video is on?
Okay, ma'am.
Ma'am, I'll just remove the other device, ma'am. Yeah, okay, perfect.
Yeah, I've removed it.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, so the use of chemotherapy in a metastatic triple negative, the VEG pathway in triple negative, you have immunotherapy, you have platinum, you have PARP inhibitors, and eribulin. And many of these tumors are AR positive tumors. So as we go on to the next slide. Okay, quick question for discussion. What is the most effective drug first in the course of treatment or you reserve it? Any of the panelists, please. Any of the panelists, please.
I would use the most effective drug first in the course of treatment rather than reserve it, because the PS is better, then it's better to give the patient upfront the most effective treatment.
Okay. Yes, next slide, please. Okay. Now, if you are using the most effective drug first, does the agent sequencing matter across the multiple lines in a metastatic breast cancer? So your opinion, any of the panelists?
Yes, ma'am. Most effective agent first with a single agent will be better than combination chemotherapy.
Tell Bhubanesh to send the today's panelist list. Okay. Tell Bhubanesh to send it. Okay. Now, if you go to the next slide.
The yes, first is the best hit and the hard hit. I think that will be the best way to go about.
Yeah. Now, if you see the molecular subtyping of the triple negative or the triple negative breast cancers, which we are going to talk today night. So if you have a metastatic breast cancer, what would be your first line of therapy?
Taxane usually, ma'am.
Taxane. What about anthracyclines? How will you go about just the single agent taxane?
Upfront
anthracycline followed by taxane. First line will be Dr. Rumson.
So your treatment will not be very much different from any routine breast cancer patient. Can we have the next slide, please? Okay. So use of taxane-based chemotherapy and the first and second line, whether it is a hormone receptor positive, HER2 positive, or triple negative, there is an improvement in overall survival in all the analyzed subset, and that still date remains the same. Next, please.
Okay. What do you prefer for your metastatic breast cancer who are eligible for chemotherapy, whether you go with monotherapy or in combination therapy? Dr. Anu?
Ma'am, I would prefer to go for sequential monotherapy, ma'am. I don't want to use all my agents upfront. In MBC, it's not been found to be useful to use all your agents together. Sequential monotherapy is what I would prefer.
Okay. Next, please. Now, if you see the sequencing monotherapy may be a preferred option in the metastatic breast cancer, if you see the European School of Oncology, ESO guidelines, international consensus for advanced disease, and also the ESMO guidelines, in the absence of a rapid clinical progression, or there is a life-threatening metastasis, or the need for rapidly symptom control, yes, a sequencing monotherapy is the best standard of care as on today. Next. Now, you see this recommendation. So what we are at this point of looking at in a monotherapy is that the preferred choice may be, and there is a reduced risk of toxicity. There is a good improvement of the quality of life. There will be symptom control, and it does not compromise with the overall survival. Yes, we are a little aggressive when the patient is highly symptomatic, visceral embolment, visceral crisis. We need higher response rate. We need rapid tumor regression. And that's one of the reasons why we are more keen towards the multiple agent chemotherapy. But then there is also reduced, there is high chance of toxicity, bad quality of life. Okay, and it does not overall affect the overall survival rate. Next, please. Okay, I think we can, if you can mute the surrounding sounds, I think a lot of sounds are there. Okay, now we... So as we discussed earlier in a metastatic breast cancer, can we have the next slide, please? Okay, as we discussed in the metastatic breast cancer, so it's a triple negative is not a single entry. Next, please. Okay, so it is prognostically distinct, different four types. I think there are several much more types. Can I have the next, please? So we are looking into, and this triple negative itself is a huge change in the genomic instability. It has high grade, it has high proliferative index, it does have a germline mutation and high prevalence of P53 mutations. And a quick question to Dr. Vidya, do you treat all triple negatives like same, or do you really do any molecular profiling when you see a triple negative breast cancer?
Basically, we have to do molecular analysis, but practically it's not possible. So all triple negative, we are treating it's the same.
Same type. We are not doing whether we are real two triple negative or basal-like tumors. So some of the triple negatives do behave well, and some of the triple negatives do really bad, particularly when you have all these expressions there. And also, these triple negative tumors do express androgen receptors, AR, where enzalutamide is one of the drug of choice. Okay, can we have the next slide, please? Okay, Dr. Nitya. Okay, so in your practice, okay, when you get a triple negative metastatic cancer, like how Dr. Vidya said that it's not possible, what do you do from the biopsy sample? What are the tests that you will be doing?
At the moment, just the basic immunohistochemistry and the basal, for the diagnosis of the basal-like tumors, we do the markers. But practically speaking, I don't know how much of these will be translated into a clinical practice, because we do AR in most of the patients with triple negative breast cancers, but I don't think we apply AR positivity right now. So it is all, as she said, it's going to be the same kind of treatment. No additional treatment until we have any particular recommendations for all this.
But in all young patients with triple negative with a family history, isn't there a recommendation to the BRCA testing, whether you do or not, as far as yes, recommendation is concerned?
In the ideal setting, yes, ma'am. But most patients, there is an apprehension about doing the BRCA testing. So those patients whom we counsel and are willing, yes, we definitely do. But that is definitely restricted to the younger patients who are less than 50 years old. And with no family history, we do tell them that it could be beneficial in the therapeutically. There might be a therapeutic application of a BRCA positivity. So we do tell them to do it. But in case they don't accept, then it's just the same kind of approach.
Yes. Apart from doing our ER, PR, HER2K67, now I think BRCA testing has become an armamentarium. Whether we do it or not, that depends upon where we practice. Like in the medical college, I will definitely not do. But yes, in my corporate practice and reimbursement patient, we do. And that has to be done for all the patients. Less than 35 years, all young women with breast cancer needs the treatment, needs the genetic testing to be done. Whereas all women with the family history of cancer, as per the NCCN guidelines, BRCA 1, BRCA 2 testing needs to be done in germline, and then if it is negative, somatic. Next, please. Okay, so we have discussed about the molecular landscape, and it is almost 7 sub-varieties are there. Okay, and again, back to you, Nitya. Do you, again, if ideal situation persists, okay, do you want to ask your pathologist to give you a clue to the type of tumor that they have seen, or you just treat them, okay, triple negative, I'll treat all together. Nitya,
ideal situation, definitely I would ask for all this, because it gives additional information on the adjunctive therapies that I could probably use depending upon the specific subtype. But yes, now it also depends upon the situation that the patient is in. So presently, we are not requesting them to do all of it. In case the patient is eligible for an additional therapy, like probably an anti-angiogenic or something like that, then we definitely take up the slide. In fact, for some of the patients, we have retrospectively gone and done the androgen receptor testing when they actually failed the most lines of therapy, so that we could actually give them some anti-androgenic therapy. So in the ideal situation, I feel that we should be doing it for all the patients so that we can treat them in a very personalized way.
Yes, ideally, yes, but may not be possible at many point of time. And what you said was very practical. Later on, we do go back to see whether the LAR androgen receptor is positive. We also look into the immunomodulator subtype, because triple negative, there's a big role of immunotherapy in triple negative. And there's more emerging data. Next, please. So again, there is a lot of molecular subclassification, and actually we need to depend upon the molecular oncologist. Next, please. Okay, so and then because of this tumor heterogeneity, and we sometimes do need to find out the least proliferative, which are the ER positive 15%, little moderate proliferative, which are the PI3 kinase, P10, AKT positives, and the first two subtypes, that is the basal one, which has high response to chemotherapy, and B2 is the poorest response to chemotherapy. Next, please. Okay, now quick question to Dr. Bindu. Okay, you know the triple negatives have a heterogeneity in this. Now, what the other panelists said, that it's not always possible to do the testing, and we don't know the molecular subtype. What is the role of platinum in treatment? Like initially, all of you said it is taxane, anthracycline, cyclophosphamide. At any point of time, introduce platinum in the first line.
In our department, it is not possible for us to do the markers. We rely upon the immunohistochemistry alone, the receptors. And in young patients, we have tried platinum with good success. A combination chemotherapy with platinum and taxane with good success, madam.
Yes, I also agree with you. Next, Dr. Jovita, again, the same question to be continued. Yes, I agree with Bindu that I do use platinum irrespective, because in the medical college setting, it is not possible to check the BRCAness of the tumor. So we do incorporate platinum in all these patients upfront, along with the taxanes, rightly said. We give 4 cycles of anthracycline, cyclophosphamide, and taxanes. So what is the data supporting? I know the data is conflicting. So how do you support yourself?
Jovita. Yes, ma'am. I'm also the same opinion, but I don't remember the clinical trials as such. So, but the thing is, in practice, I also do use, couple the taxane along with the carboplatin and treat
after the anthracycline.
Yes. Yeah, there is conflicting data. The Geopard trial and many of them have looked into platinum. Yes, we do, but I have an excellent response of triple negatives with the platinum. If I had forgotten to give the platinum, those are the patients who come back. Like I, we also presented our data in one of the UAE conference with the locally advanced metastatic disease with very good response rate and longer progression-free survival. But then with international data, if you see the guidelines, again, there's conflicting data. They are saying do the BRCA-ness and give the platinum. But in a developing country like India, yes, anyone wants to put a word about the platinum, it's an important drug. What about Anu? What about Nitya and Vidya? The role of platinum in this cancer?
Yeah, ma'am, we do use platinum, it is carboplatin, especially in combination in our young breast cancer. Again, I'm not routinely doing BRCA for all the patients, as you rightly said. It might not be feasible in our setup, but I would prefer to use them in the young patients, especially. It gives a good response, is what I have clinically found.
Yes. Nitya and Vidya, just quick one line of carboplatin and platinum, and then we move on to the next bit.
Yes, ma'am. For a young patient, triple negative, platinum will be beneficial along with the actions.
We have used it in some patients, but generally the first line of therapy would be a combination of anthracycline and taxane in our institution. Younger patients, yes, because of the specific response to patients who carry the BRCA mutation, we do consider it in very young patients, but otherwise the standard of care is in our institution is a combination of anthracycline and taxane whenever they need a combination therapy.
Okay, sure. Can you go to the next slide? Okay, so in a patient, whether you have given an anthracycline, taxane, plus or minus platinum, and this patient has... Okay, Bindu, Nitya, Bindu.
Madam,
Nitya, please.
Hear the question, madam, it is not clear.
What would be your second line of therapy in the triple negative who has failed anthracycline, taxane, platinum?
Gemcitabine with already paclitaxel has been given. Might be gemcitabine alone or capecitabine.
Okay, anybody else wants to take this? What would be your...
In the second line, after failure of anthracycline and taxane, we have a good experience with platinum and eribulin. We have not given single agent eribulin for most patients, and given a good performance status, we do give it in combination with platinum. And there have been excellent responses when given in the second line. That would be my choice.
Okay. What about Dr. Jovita and the others? She says that platinum and eribulin. What are the other thought process? Do you bring in molecular studies at this point of time if you have not done earlier? Because there is also a role of bevacizumab, immunotherapy, PARP inhibitors, ER. So quick comment from the other panelist.
Yes, ma'am. If the patient affordable, we can do all that.
Okay. Logistics in place.
I would prefer to do it after failure of second line, which would be eribulin.
Okay, so you would like to give an eribulin, platinum or single agent. Okay, anybody else?
I would do a PD-L1 and an MSI, and then if it is negative, I would go with eribulin. If the patient prefers IV therapy, if he prefers oral, I would probably prefer capecitabine.
Okay. What about PARP inhibitors? We have generic PARP inhibitors available now.
After failure of capecitabine and anthracycline, yes, that is an option. But yes. I prefer to keep it for the third line probably.
Another third line if you have a chemo drug. Next, please. Okay, now quickly we go into the data of the this is the first line, that's what is available. Yes, platinum, like many of you said, gemcitabine is available. Bevacizumab is a drug which can be given. Capecitabine, yes, is an option. Okay, along, and vinorelbine capecitabine is also a good option in first line for these metastatic disease. And in all the guidelines, there is vinorelbine. We don't use vinorelbine because of the line. Sometimes the line patency is not good and it has a lot of local reaction. But vinorelbine is a lovely drug to be used. We do use in the medical college on several patients. Even with lung cancer, I use vinorelbine with platinum. So, and second line, yes, vinorelbine, capecitabine, eribulin is in the armamentarium, and now paclitaxel can be used. Like rightly said, many people are using single agent and many are using it combining with any of the other drugs. I think there are a lot of studies coming in with not eribulin, not as a single agent, with another drug. Now, third line, yes, some of you said you want to keep the PARP inhibitors in hand, and see, if you have not used the drug, you can use it. Next, please. But then definitely, next slide, please. Definitely in the treatment armamentarium, the molecular typing still comes in. And I think this is taken from the NCCN, and it's a little older slide, the 2017. We will not discuss, but definitely eribulin has a better take over here with the quality of which has quite effective, and then with the having a good response rate, and there is improvement in the symptoms and quality of life is extremely good. As we go on to the next slide, I will start from Jovita, your experience with eribulin. And as you see, it's highly effective and it is there on the card, and I have been using for quite some time. The original molecule, and the company gives huge support programs. So I have a couple of patients on eribulin and they continued for quite long. So the experience and the feeling is quite good about the drug. So quick question from, I want to know from the others, how much have you used and what is your experience? Jovita.
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. I have used an eribulin and probably have crossed with a few patients 12 months or so. But the only problem here is peripheral neuropathy, I think, was a little too annoying, and also neutropenia.
Okay. Next, Dr. Anu Susan. Dr. Anu, please.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, my experience with the eribulin.
Dr. Bindu, or anybody, Nitya, we want to know about the eribulin.
It's fairly well tolerated, ma'am, except that I also neutropenia has an issue for some patients. Otherwise, it's fairly well tolerated. I've only used single agent, not used in combination.
And in Alapi Medical College, between 2015 and 18 patients treated with eribulin. All the patients, the ESA pharmaceuticals have given free of cost to all patients every cycle. Just 18 patients we have used. Afterwards, the hospital has stopped taking free drugs from the pharmaceuticals. Our experience was fairly good. It was used as third line, single agent. There were only 4 triple negative patients though. And afterwards, we have assessed the response. There was no patient with complete response. 66.6% patients had a partial response. There was progression in the disease in 22.2% of patients and a stable disease in 11.1% patients. But all 4 patients who were triple negative had a partial response. And with the adverse effects, most of the patients had fatigue and neuropathy. These were the most common issues. Patients were also having alopecia and neutropenia. And we encountered neutropenia even on the day 8. So many patients, we couldn't give day 1, day 8, and day 21. We had to postpone the day 8 eribulin. And the experience was fairly good. Patients were very happy. Good symptom relief and good quality of life was there. We treated like 6 patients had bone metastasis and the rest 12 patients had visceral metastasis. This is our experience, madam.
Okay, anybody else wants to share their experience with eribulin?
Yes, ma'am. We have used a combination of mostly used a combination of platinum and eribulin in the second line setting in HER2 positive and triple negative. Initially, we were using it in the HER2 positive relapse also. But now we have additional targeted therapy, so we stopped using, and now it's exclusively being used for patients who are triple negative. We have around, we've given around 15 to 18 patients till date, and I remember two of them having a complete response. They had a local recurrence, and we were able to subject them to a repeat surgery. And the tolerability is actually good. The neutropenia for these patients was not clinically significant. The main issue here was the neuropathy. Most of these patients developed neuropathy very early, maybe in the 1.5, 2.5 cycles, and that was really troublesome. But with symptomatic treatment, they were able to complete the course of therapy. And in our experience, it has been a very good drug. And thanks to the support given by the ESAI people, so it was very good.
Okay, yes, I have also used it, but then what we do in our practice, because these are metastatic patients who have failed first line, we give it day 1 and day 15, not the day 1 and day 8. Okay, so much of neuropathy, in fact, the patients has no complaints for the patients which I have treated so far. And we will place the drug in a 2-weekly interval, and the patients are also happy for coming. Just a quick comment about day 1 and day 15. It's a palliative setting. Anybody wants to comment?
Looks very feasible, ma'am.
And we also combine with another drug, not as a single agent. Maybe capecitabine is also another drug of choice we give, because all of our patients, we do give platinum upfront. Yes, next, please. So, and quickly, can you go through the slides? Let us review. Can you shift the slides? So the VEGF pathway, next please, that is the BitRace trial, and then bevacizumab is also an important role combined with chemotherapy, and most of the international guidelines has bevacizumab included. Okay, yes, next please. So BRCA1, BRCA2 typing is very important, and you have PARP inhibitors like all of you rightly pointed out, and you have the generic, you have the original molecule, and the generic may be quite affordable if somebody cannot afford the original. So think about PARP inhibitors. If it is BRCA positive, try to give them the benefit of the drug. Next, please. Okay, so the Cochrane review does recommend platinum containing regimes for metastatic cancer. Next, please. Quickly, can we have the slides, because we are running short of time? Okay, and triple negative, the difference in treatment between a metastatic compared with unselected of the borderline statistical significant. Next. So some studies said there were no improvement in survival, others did show an improvement in the survival. So we need more randomized studies, okay, to document this. Next, please. So that data still remains remains with us, that the thing to be answered. Now, another quick question to all of you. Now, if you have a PD-L1 positive, have you used the new data with the atezolizumab, bevacizumab, nab-paclitaxel, and platinum? Anybody, please. Rovita, Anu, Brinda, and Nitya, and Vidya also.
We have just started using it for triple negative breast cancers who have failed the first 2-3 lines of therapy based on the PD-L1. So in the second line, if the patient stops responding or doesn't have a satisfactory response, we do look back at, in fact, we've started doing it along with the ERPR now, since there is evidence for immunotherapy. So we have a couple of patients, and one of them is doing very well. She's into the 6th month of therapy, I think, and she's doing very well. The other person is just enrolled. We've just started using it. We don't have so much of evidence to say how effective it would be in the long run.
Yes, I have also used on 2 patients, but it's exorbitantly expensive. I have used it only on a reimbursement sector. 2 patients are on. Okay, though we think that it is 4 drugs toxicity, we place it in a 4-weekly interval, but so far so good. Stable disease. Yes, my number of patients is also less than 4 months of therapy is on. But then that is any one of you had tried this protocol for drugs? It is quite expensive. The data sometimes says that the toxicity is also high. No, ma'am.
Not use, ma'am. I've only used with paclitaxel. Paclitaxel only.
Okay. Now, a quick question to all of you, starting from Vidya. What will you do if you don't have access to your molecular studies and patient cannot afford BRCA inhibitors, all these immunotherapies which we are talking about? What would be your next line of chemotherapy be drugs after eribulin fails?
Capecitabine, if it's not used before, ma'am.
Capecitabine, if not taken. But there now many people are using because of the data and the triple negative with residual disease. Okay, that's quite a good thing. Anybody else? What would be your third line when other molecular targets is not an option?
Capecitabine is a good option, and I would consider other single agents like gemcitabine also in a weekly form, day 1, day 8, and day 15. That is also quite well tolerated. Main problem will be the neutropenia because the marrow is already burnt out. So for me, capecitabine for a period of time, I think it would be doing a great job in controlling the tumor growth when we are no longer expecting a very dramatic response.
Okay. Now with paucity of time, can we skip and go to the last few slides, please? Okay, where we have the conclusion, we can jump this next, please. Okay, as you can continue, please continue. Okay, we'll have the last four slides before we sign off for today. Next, continue. Yeah, so we have already discussed VARP inhibitors, immunotherapy, AR, all these are some of the data which are coming up and is in the armamentarium for the treatment of these triple negative. Yeah, yes, and we go from here. Okay, so we have seen that the eribulin significantly improved the survival, overall survival, and it has a trimodal, now can you just slow down? So trimodal therapy, and this eribulin also causes a remodeling, increased functional vessels in the tumor, reduces hypoxia, prevents the tumor from transforming into a more malignant subtype, sensitizes the tumor to the immune cells. So yes, immunotherapy does is an option after you fail the eribulin. Next, please. And let's discuss the algorithm. Okay, and for these tumors, next, please. So, and that's how you place it in the management of triple negative tumors. And yes, BRCA-ness of the tumor is one thing you need to definitely assess, and the PD-L1 status. Yes, if PD-L1 is positive, atezolizumab, nab-paclitaxel is an important choice. If you have a BRCA-ness in the tumor, PARP inhibitors or platinum-based therapy. If both PD-L1 and germ cell BRCA is positive, yes, use both the drugs together. But if you don't have, like many of our cases will not be having the PD-L1 and the BRCA-ness. So there we have the taxanes, we have the bevacizumab, anthracyclines are the crux of therapy. And once they fail first line, eribulin, either single agent is or in combination is an important armamentarium. As we also discussed, gemcitabine, vinorelbine, capecitabine forms a subsequent lines of chemotherapeutic agents for these patients. Next, please. And this summary, so that brings us almost to the conclusion. It's not a single disease. It is important to understand what we are dealing with. Yes, I do understand logistics in general patients. It's difficult to do the molecular subtyping. We treat them all. And even if you do the molecular typing, it may not be possible to give therapy. Yes, immunotherapy is an immediate option. Atezolizumab, pembrolizumab is approved. BRCA, PARP inhibitors is approved. With the generics, it has made more affordable. Remember, our drug eribulin, very safe, minimum side effects, nice dosing with good company support, can be used in second line in failed metastatic triple negative breast cancers, which will give you a good quality of life. And you saw the NCCN guidelines recommendation with the great scoring for toxicity, good response rate, and excellent quality of life. Yes, new trials, clinical drugs, and newer drugs and clinical trials are on the way, and then it will lead us to a more brighter future of these women who have a brave outlook. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I now request Mr. Bala from Eisai Pharmaceuticals. Please give the closing remarks. Over to you, Mr. Bala.
Good evening to everyone. On behalf of ESAI, I would like to thank all the faculty for this Women's Oncology meeting. Especially, I would like to thank Dr. Anita Ramesh from Kaveri Hospital, Dr. Jovita Martin from SRMC, Dr. Anu Susan from Lakeshore Hospital, Cochin, Dr. Bindu from Alappi Medical College, Dr. Nitya from ES Hospital, and Dr. Vidya from Universal Hospital, Salem. And thank you everyone for making this Women's Oncology meeting successful. We would like to partner with you for all the future Women's Oncology meeting, and thank you everyone.